Very good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Morning. This morning, welcome all of you. I'm happy to see everybody. This morning, I'd like to share with you a lesson on the Christian warfare. Christian warfare. What is Christian warfare? I'm talking about a war. That's why we read the book of Joshua. How God also asked Joshua to conquer and conquer and conquer to take the land of Canaan. How they are conquering tribe by tribe, and then they were victorious. So similarly, Christians also have a war to fight. Just like physical war, we have spiritual war. So when we think of war, we think of combat, you know, the earnestness of combat, the seriousness. War is not a fun thing, you know, just play, not a game that we play. It's very serious. When we think of combat, think of contest, fight each other, fight to their death. That's how serious they are. Sometimes when you see them fighting, you can see a lot of competition. Sometimes they really fight to their deaths. Just to win the competition. This is how serious they treat it has to be. So are we serious on this spiritual warfare? So war is a terribly earnest business, which will not bear mere half-hearted trifling. When Joshua led the children of Israel in Canaan, the fighting done to drive out the pagan inhabitants of that land was extensive. That means there were the pagans who were inhabiting in the land of Canaan. So they had to drive out the inhabitants there in order to settle in the land. God allowed that. And God said, what did God say? God said, you need to, God directly spoke to Joshua. He said, you need to smote all the land, the whole country, and the south, and the lowland, and the slopes, and all their kings, and left nothing remaining, and utterly destroyed all that breathed, as Jehovah, the Lord God, commanded. Joshua chapter 10, verse 14, is one of the instructions that God gave to Joshua, that he need to leave no survivor, to utterly destroy all who breathe. That means, it means complete, clean up everything. It's very serious. God is very serious in clearing all that is foreign. He wants to start everything new. No sooner had this campaign been waged successfully and the kings of the neighboring regions decided to fight, Israel left its invasions come against them, then Joshua had to gear his army to fight again. See, he has to get ready again, a lot of other tribes. And in Joshua chapter 11 verse 14, that's another time, Joshua captured all the cities of the kings and all these their kings and destroyed them with the edge of the sword and utterly destroyed them. Just like Moses, the servant of the Lord had commanded. This is what God commanded Joshua to do as a leader. Because Joshua is the one who actually is the successor after Moses left. Moses was taken into heaven. Then Joshua and Caleb were the two ones who were the remaining old generation who was able to enter the promised land. Of the old generation, all passed away, except Caleb and Joshua, who were not, as people say, they were not having any grasshopper complex. They know that God has delivered the land into their hands. So what we can learn is the determination to win. To win. God's people would have failed to receive their rightful inheritance if they are not determined to win. What about the modern times? We look at the World War I, World War II. It would have ended much differently, and recent world survey would have, history would have been drastically sorrier than it was, being if United States had geared for anything less than total war efforts against our enemies. What happened is, we know from history, American history, that how America later bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And that only stopped them from invading. That one really stopped them. If they are not serious, let's say they only just want to clear part of the city, they will not be able, they will not have stopped. Japanese, then World War II will still be continued. In 1945, they surrendered. So this is what you can learn from world history and also from the Bible. But how do you apply from us, from the facts of the Old Testament? Christian life, how does it affect us? It's a spiritual warfare. It is not, as Paul says, against the principalities. I mean, against the physically you are fighting. But it is a spiritual warfare, and nothing less than a total commitment to victory over Satan and sin will prevail. What is our plan of action? What is our plan of action? What do we do about it? How can we prepare for it? We need to prepare for battle. It is a real battle we have to fight. That's why the Bible is full of these instructions that we need. We are fighting a spiritual warfare. So we cannot fight it alone. We need our commander. And Christ is our commander. He is the one who enlisted us into his army. We are in the army of God, our army of Christ. Many people do not see the total challenge of Christian living. Why? Why did I say this? Because Christian living is conversion. It's total conversion. Turning over a new leaf. You need to be converted to Christ. Others see it as a nominal and affiliation, an occasional attendance and contribution. To these people, being a Christian is no mere practical significance, just a nominal, superficial, and seasonal thing, and not a consuming passion in their lives. So sometimes they are guilty of this, that we do not have this passion. We don't have this passion for souls in our lives. Sometimes you talk to people say, I'm attending another denomination church. Say, we have 500 members, but only 50 of them active. See, this is what is happening, that many people are not committed. Committed. Just like in the body of Christ. We need to be committed. That's how, what do we do to commit ourselves? We need to do something about it. If we are not committed, we need to, as they say, resolve to do it. Christianity has lost ground because of the shallow view and the complacent attitude of Christians. Are we complacent in our lives for Christ? Are we complacent that we are happy, that we are Christian, and we are comfortable in our own lives, and we forgot about many who are lost? There was once a story